Say that you a baller. You lame, can't play this game. Step up to the plate, cause you say that you a baller. At the top, this is how I rock.
Welcome into another episode of The Rebound. I'm Rachel Holt. I'm joined by Darren Hartwell. And Darren, we have a lot to talk about today, so buckle up.
Yeah, special NBA trade deadline version of The Rebound. Very exciting
stuff. The NBA trade deadline has obviously come and gone. And the Celtics, they didn't make any big moves. There was a lot of talk about Marcus Smart potentially being traded, and it looks like he's staying put. So do you think the Celtics made a smart decision?
I
know you appreciated that.
I do. I think, you know, considering what was on the table, they reportedly were trying to get a first-round pick for him. Apparently that market, you know, didn't get realized. And I think that, you know, considering where the Celtics are as a team right now, first place in the East, yeah, you could argue they needed to maybe go after a guy like Tyreke Evans, but the Grizzlies wanted a first-round pick for Evans. Celtics covet those first-round picks.
They sure do.
So, I think the Celtics probably made the right move considering, you know, where they stand in the Eastern Conference right now. Obviously, have Gordon Hayward still potentially coming back this season or next season. So, I think... You know, any move that the Celtics made might have been a little bit overreactionary, so I like what they did.
Hey, we can't forget about that guy, Gordon Hayward. Another new face to the Celtics roster, Greg Monroe. He's a brand new free agent acquisition. Monroe will possibly make his debut with the team on Thursday. He's already in D.C. Check out this picture. On Wednesday, he was repping Celtics gear, so how much will Monroe impact the Seas?
Yeah, so, you know, they weren't completely quiet ahead of the trade deadline. You know, no moves on actual deadline day. But I think Monroe provides some front court depth. I think he's a good pickup for the Celtics. He's always played well against the Celtics when he was on the Milwaukee Bucks. Kind of a big guy, grabs a lot of rebounds. Marcus Morris was injured recently, so, you know, kind of add Monroe into the mix with Aaron Baines. And, I think this definitely helps them. You know, there's also a rumor that the Celtics could go after Joe Johnson on the buyout market. So I think right now their plan is to kind of explore the buyout market, just add guys to the roster instead of, giving up assets to go to try to make deals.
Well, just because the Celtics didn't do anything crazy doesn't mean that this wasn't a crazy trade deadline. Now let's take a look at everything that went down today. Joel Embiid said it best. Wow, this is crazy, LOL. The NBA is amazing. It sure is. Yeah. Woj dropped the bomb on us around noon. Cleveland is sending Isaiah Thomas and Channing Frye to the Lakers for Jordan Clarkson and Larry Nance. They also traded Dwayne Wade to Miami. LeBron James posted about this in an Instagram post, very sweet here, saying goodbye to his good buddy. They also send former Celtic Jay Crowder and Derrick Rose to Utah. They're basically getting a whole new team.
Yeah, they just, they hit the nuclear button, just blew everything up. I guess for Celtics fans, the most shocking thing is Isaiah Thomas. On another team, he played all of 15 games.
Oh, my goodness.
And now is on his third team in, a span of under 6 months. And could be fourth because, you know, his contract is expiring. And the Lakers could opt to, you know, part ways with him after the 2018 season, so he could be on the move again. So, but in terms of the Cavs, this is just a complete roster overhaul. They're getting younger. You know, who knows what LeBron James's future holds, but clearly, they're trying. This aging roster wasn't really working out. They had a lot of, you know, guys who weren't really getting along. A lot of veterans who weren't really getting along. So. Why not just bring in, like, a completely new team and see what happens, I guess?
Well, IT said he did want to stay in Cleveland. He was tired of getting traded, so I personally am looking forward to seeing his reaction to this news.
Yeah.
Someone who already spoke about it is Fry. Let's see what he had to say.
Just want to say thank you to all the Cavs fans, Cleveland, everybody. Business is business. I'm off to the Lakers. It happens. I'm excited. Good, nice, great young team. And word to everybody, don't go 0-6 or they're going to trade your ass.
So let's talk about what happened here or what went wrong for the team. I mean, Isaiah Thomas, he just really didn't seem to fit in ever since he went to Cleveland. And he was vocal about his frustrations. So what was the biggest issue there?
Yeah, I guess to quote LeBron James, I think he fit out instead of fitting in. That was for Kevin Love back in the day. But yeah, I think there were just too many primary ball handlers. And I think, you know, Isaiah was used to dominating the offense in Boston. And obviously you go from that to playing with LeBron James, who's, you know, the best player in the NBA, but he's going to run the offense. He's everything runs through him. He's also very demanding of his teammates. You know, obviously there's the injury factor too. You know, Isaiah didn't make his Cavs debut until January 2nd, and he was dealing with a hip injury. And he's a very he's a guy who's very outspoken. He, you know, says what's on his mind. And I think given all the drama that usually surrounds the Cavs every year, it's, you know, it's kind of a regular thing. But I think adding Isaiah to the mix, both the off-court stuff and the on-court stuff, it just didn't seem like a great fit. And I think also Kyrie Irving going to the Celtics, that really hurt LeBron too, one of the best point guards in the NBA.
Well, speaking of some drama, this actually solves one issue. See, the Cavs were supposed to come to town on Sunday to face the Celtics. Paul Pierce's jersey is being retired, and they were going to play IT's tribute video, but there was an issue with that. Pierce didn't like the fact that he was sharing his special moment with IT, but now it just doesn't matter at this point. The Celtics and the Lakers actually don't play each other for the rest of the season, so I don't know what they're going to do with the video. Hopefully they play it at some point. But let's talk about what this means for the Celtics. The team is 39-16. They're currently in first place in the Eastern Conference. They didn't need to do the things that the Cavs needed to do to their team to be ahead. So where does this leave the team?
Yeah, I think right now you have to look at the Toronto Raptors as the biggest threat. Obviously, this changes things for the Cavs. Maybe this new roster with Rodney Hood and George Hill and Clarkson and Larry Nance, they could gel maybe with LeBron James, who knows? But I think right now, the Raptors are only one game back of the Celtics. Obviously, just played the other night. Raptors beat the Celtics pretty handily, and I think the Raptors are a serious threat. I think you could see in the Eastern Conference Finals, I could easily see in the Eastern Conference Finals between those two teams. The one knock on the Raptors has been their playoff performance. They're a very good regular season team, and they come up short in the playoffs. But I think the way DeMar DeRozan is playing this season, he's having best season of his career. Kyle Lowry also playing well. They have a very strong bench. So I think that's going to be the battle to watch in the East.
Well, let's talk about that last game on Tuesday. As you mentioned, a very lopsided loss for the Celtics, 111-91, their second largest margin of defeat so far this season. Irving returned from an injury, so that's a good sign. He finished with 17 points over 22 minutes. He actually didn't play that well. Overall, the team kind of played with a low level of intensity. The Celtics and the Raptors, they'll play two more times in the regular season. So any concerns about this game, given the fact that these two teams will likely meet at some point in the postseason?
Yeah, I think I guess you could say the silver lining for the Celtics is that they didn't have Marcus Smart, and I think that was on full display. I think, you know, it was basically the Raptors' second unit, you know, outplaying the Celtics' second unit, and Marcus Smart is a big part of the Celtics' second unit, so I think not having him played a big role in their loss. You know, they also just didn't get any balanced scoring. You know, Al Horford had 2 points, Jason Tatum had 4 points. that's not going to cut it. You know, you need more consistent scoring, and I think that's probably the Celtics' biggest area of concern. Obviously, you have great players like Kyrie Irving. Tatum and Jaylen Brown have been pretty solid, but, you know, someone else needs to step up, maybe a guy like Terry Rozier, Smart once he comes back, and actually contribute and take some of the scoring load off Kyrie.
Well, let's look ahead to the rest of their schedule here. Pre-All-Star, they actually have a pretty tough stretch ahead of them. Yep. The All-Star game, of course, is February 18th. They play the Wizards, Pacers, Cavs, and Clippers. I think I know the answer to this, but which one of those games do you have circled on your calendar? Do you have a calendar, by the way?
Oh, yeah, I have a calendar.
You have it circled on there?
Maybe it's on my iPhone, but yeah, I'm really looking forward to this game against the Pacers. You know, no, I'm just kidding. It's the Cavs. you know, It was the Cavs before, you know, it was a big deal before Isaiah Thomas got traded, and maybe it's slightly less of a big deal, but, you know, it's going to be fascinating to see this completely new roster coming to Boston. Obviously, there's the Paul Pierce tribute video, too. Nesson.com will have a full squad there,
we'll
I guess
be
you
there.
Could say.
Yeah,
we'll be there.
Rolling
so
deep.
It'll be a very exciting game to see, you know, whether the Cavs are this new Cavs team stacks up with the Celtics.
Yeah, very excited to be at that game and bring you all the latest from there. Injured players returned in the last game. Kyrie Irving and Marcus Morris returned to the lineup on Tuesday in Toronto. What did you make of their play?
Yeah, I mean, Kyrie looked a little rusty. Mm-hmm. That quad injury, you know, I guess it's a good thing that it's his quad and not his knee, because he's had knee injury issues in the past. Morris actually played okay, you know, 12 points, but he was a He's a minus 20 plus minus, which is not what you want. That's not good. and, you know, so obviously guys coming back from injury, it takes them a little while. Like I said, I think those guys will be fine, but the big loss was Marcus Smart.
Yeah, Marcus Smart not only coming back to the team, which we weren't sure about, yep. but he'll be back after the All-Star break. Now, of course, you can see this tweet from him. He had missed some time after hitting a picture frame, so we hope that he learned his lesson there.
Yes.
Given the fact that the Celtics do want him that badly, that they're keeping him on the team.
Yeah, definitely hope he learned his lesson because the Celtics are putting their faith in him.
They are.
Maybe wear gloves or something.
Or just don't hit any picture frames.
Yeah.
How about that, Darren?
Yeah.
The Celtics aren't the only ones dealing with injuries at this point. Around the league, a lot of star players going down. Kristaps Porzingis, he tore his ACL on Tuesday. Devastating to see this. Here are some reactions from fellow athletes.
Mm-hmm.
Everyone just devastated by this news. You hate to see a player of this caliber go down for a reason like this. There's a theory LeBron James's All-Star team is cursed. Porzingis is the fourth member to suffer an injury since the team was announced. You also had DeMarcus Cousins, who tore his ACL. You had Kevin Love, who injured his hand, who will be out 6 to 8 weeks. You have John Wall, who underwent surgery on his left knee. He will miss 6 to 8 weeks. So, point is, don't be drafted by LeBron James.
That's kind of crazy. And then also, I guess you could say, Kyrie Irving is also on Team LeBron, and he missed a few games with a quad injury. So
there
it's
you go.
Just it's going around. Like you said, don't want to be on Team LeBron. That's like on par with a Madden curse or Sports Illustrated curse. That's some rough stuff.
Well, who is on Team LeBron at this point? We actually don't know. I have to go check out who is on the Cavs. I forget. Despite the injuries, the All-Star game, it may actually be pretty good this year, and there's a good reason for that. Why? Because there's money involved. Money makes the world go round. In the past, members of the winning team have earned $50,000. This year, they get $100,000. Now, to an NBA player, I don't know how much that is to them. To me, it seems like a lot of money, so we may get a better show this year.
Yeah, and I think it's also going to be fascinating to have the two teams drafted by Curry and LeBron instead of the traditional East-West matchup. You know, you have LeBron playing with Kyrie. You have, all sorts of storylines, players crossing divisions. So I think it's gonna be fun.
Yeah, money never hurts too. Speaking of money, the Celtics are valued at $2.5 billion. Last year, they were worth $2.2 billion, so they're going up in value. Remember, Wick Grosbeck bought the team in 2002 for $360 million.
Yeah.
So he made a little bit of a profit there.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and that's, Celtics, arrow is pointing up in both on the floor and in the bank account. That's what happens when you add Kyrie Irving and Gordon Hayward in the offseason. That certainly helps the bottom line.
And Darren, not everyone can make money, so we're going to end on this note. Terry Rozier, he actually lost hundreds of thousands of dollars for what seems like a really silly reason. I'll let you get into this.
Yeah, this was kind of fascinating. So apparently during the last NBA Eastern Conference Finals against the Cavs, he was warming up and he wore Nikes during shoot-around. And he is sponsored by Adidas. He has been since 2016. And apparently someone from Adidas noticed and informed him the next day, or a couple days later, that his contract would be terminated. So they sent him a letter basically like, you're done with us. You're wearing Nike shoes instead of Adidas shoes, even though he changed into Adidas shoes during the game.
Yeah.
The contract was reportedly worth, I think, like $300,000 over three years.
That's
so,
a lot of money.
Don't wear the wrong shoes.
No, Rozier called Adidas a jealous ex.
Yeah, so. I'd be mad at them too. And now he's rocking the Nikes this year, so he's going all in. And I think sounds like he's getting over it.
I guess we can't feel too bad for him. I think he's doing just fine for himself.
Yeah.
Obviously, a lot of news to dissect. And you're going to be heading to the computer right after this and getting on it, because there was just so much that went on today. So, as always, make sure you keep it on Nesson.com for all your NBA and Celtics news. And thanks for tuning in.